Rosenstein, my sister Sabrina, and her boyfriend John were murdered in December 1980. There's a million questions that you never, ever stop thinking about and worrying about. It's like yesterday. 25 years have gone by, and we do not know what happened that night.
And the crime scene basically was an undeveloped area, open fields, heavy brush. I'm Ray Biondi, former lieutenant with Sacramento County Sheriff's Department. When we looked at the crime scene, we were looking at someone who came equipped to kill people.
The young man is down at the bottom of the ditch, face up.
John Riggins had duct tape wrapped around his eyes and his nose and his mouth. That somebody had slit his throat. There was physical evidence that he had received a blow to the head, which is indication that he probably put up a fight.
The girl is face down.
Sabrina, who is further down in the ditch, had a severe cut to her throat. This was a very dangerous kind of person, that we were either looking for somebody who's done this before.
Sabrina and John were adorable together. It was her first boyfriend and his first girlfriend. John wanted to do medicine, like his dad, perfect SAT scores, he was brilliant. Sabrina was quiet and poised, so compassionate and so sweet and so loving. Over and over, we kept saying, why? Why could this, how could this happen? Why would anybody want to do this?
How was someone able to abduct these two people? And why did they commit this horrific crime?
It turns out, after all this time, there was a crucial piece of evidence just sitting there.
Tonight, a major development in that 24-year-old case.
We were so excited. Finally, there was a break in the case. Who would have imagined that Sabrina's birthday gift to me might solve her murder?
The Sweetheart Murders, tonight's 48 Hours Mystery. Continues in 90 seconds.
Wherever you are in life, it continues to haunt you and affect you.
Your memory of the events following your sister's murder is so clear.
Uh-huh.
25 years later.
Oh, you never forget things that are that painful. It's not just death, it's murder. It's 100 times worse, and it's wrong.
More than 25 years have passed since Andrea Gonzalez Rosenstein lost her beloved baby sister Sabrina in a savage double murder. And not a day goes by that she doesn't think of her.
And what's this book?
I did this in memory of her. I just did lots of pictures of her growing up. We loved the beach, she loved to swim. She especially loved the horses with me. I've made a real effort in my life to connect her into my life, her memory into my life, in any way that I can.
That connection is very much alive in Andrea's firstborn, whom she named after her sister. Ever since she was a small child, Sabrina Rosenstein, now 22, was aware of her family's loss.
Was there always a sense that you were different from other kids when you were growing up?
There was always a sense of something terrible that had happened to my family that most people haven't experienced and can't understand, that you never know when something's gonna happen.
When bad things can happen.
Bad things can happen and change everything.
It didn't seem like anything bad could happen back in the summer of 1980. Sabrina Gonzalez was dating John Riggins and working for the recreation department in the town of Davis, California. They were both 18, about to start college, and in love.
Look at the pictures of them playing with the children in the city of Davis. She and John were going to have 6 kids. They had names picked out for them. They wanted a big family. They had so much to offer the world.
John Riggins was a hometown hero.
He excelled in sports.
A popular high school athlete and the son of a prominent physician.
I think he got a great enjoyment out of life at this point in time, and he had all the world to look forward to.
And with his red hair, he attracted so much attention. When we went out in public, everyone wanted to touch John. And he was our firstborn, and we, of course, were very proud of him.
He showed great promise.
Oh, I think he did, absolutely.
But those dreams would disappear into the thick fog the night of December 20th, 1980. Sabrina and John were expected at Andrea's birthday party that night, but they never showed. By morning, with still no sign of the couple, Andrea's disappointment turned into fear.
The fog would sock in Davis for days sometimes, but that night was really, really bad. And I thought maybe the van went off the road and they're in the field somewhere hurt and we have to find them.
The police insisted they had to wait 24 hours before they could begin searching. Besides, they said Sabrina and John had probably eloped. But Sabrina's mother, Kim, knew better.
You knew. Your gut told you that something horrible
happened. I positively knew. I were furious and said, no, this is completely out of character. These are not typical 18-year-olds, or whatever a typical 18-year-old is, that they would never do this.
Because Sabrina had never, ever, in her whole life, not let me know where she was. So I knew right away that something terrible had happened. I didn't know what.
So that morning, the Riggins family and friends organized their own search. But police finally found the van a day later, abandoned some 20 miles from Davis. Someone had rummaged through it, even tearing open the gifts that were meant for Andrea. But there was no sign of Sabrina or John.
But I knew she was dead, because I knew her so well. I prayed that they would find her body, because I didn't think I could live if I didn't know where she was.
Hours later, the search was over. The bodies had been hidden in the brush.
The young man's throat has been cut.
We were so emotionally numb. It's as though you just have no feeling. It was, everything is just drained out of you.
We have not turned over the young girl's body yet to make a closer inspection, so that's going to be done right now.
But she would never dream that something so awful would happen.
It had looked like both victims had simply been thrown into the ditch, discarded as used garbage.
Ray Biondi, now retired, was a detective with the Sacramento Sheriff's Department.
What were you thinking when you saw the condition of the bodies and how they were wrapped with duct tape?
That we were looking at somebody who came prepared to commit these murders, was not afraid to get up close and personal and kill the victims, had absolutely no regard for other human lives.
There were signs that Sabrina had been sexually assaulted.
The only obvious motive that we could think of was probably a sexual assault on Sabrina Gonzalez. And then again, also, there are people who simply kill because they like to kill.
But to think that it was sexually motivated is unbelievably horrible to me. That someone wanted pleasure in sex and was willing to kill her to get it is just the worst possible why that there could be.
Biondi tagged the victim's clothing to be tested for bodily fluids, along with another item. blanket found in the van that was a birthday present for Andrea.
This is the condominium where Sabrina lived with her older sister, Andrea.
Right.
Biondi believes the killer was lying in wait as Sabrina and John left her apartment on their way to Andrea's birthday party.
Logically, this would have been the place the abduction took place.
Right here.
Somewhere in this area. Somewhere that was deserted, less potential for witnesses. We're told that there was virtually no one around the apartment complex during that time. Most people are away on Christmas vacation. Top of that, it was a night of extreme fog.
The murders of these UC Davis sweethearts generated hundreds of calls to the police. They released this composite sketch, hoping they'd find the killer before he struck again.
So you thought there were other victims out there?
There were either other victims from the past or there were going to be future victims.
When John Riggins and Sabrina Gonzalez were murdered, it seemed as though the entire town of Davis was grieving. Not only for the victims, but also for its own loss of innocence.
I remember driving to the funeral in the car thinking, now for the rest of my life, I'll know there never really ever is a superhero. There's no magical, wonderful thing that will prevent evil things from happening.
And with her sister's killer still on the loose, police told Andrea she had a special reason to be afraid.
They said you live in the same apartment, and so it's possible that you were targeted instead of her. I cannot express how horrifying it would be to me that it would have been my fault, that I would have rather die than have her die at any time.
Sabrina's mother was also struggling to comprehend the devastating loss. She decided that she needed to visit the site where the bodies were found.
It's horrifying. And your whole job as a parent is to protect your kids anyway. And when you can't protect them, you feel horrible.
As the weeks turned into months, police worked the hundreds of leads they received.
There were a lot of calls, a lot of leads. We thought we'd end up with some viable information because of the amount of calls we were receiving on the case.
Detective Ray Biondi was hopeful the crime scene would yield some clues as well.
Inside the van, there were literally hundreds of unidentified latent fingerprints. We were hoping that they might come up with somebody very interesting, but as it was, we did not.
One by one, each lead eventually went nowhere. Police were at a loss.
Waiting day after day, month after month, and there are no arrests. There are no solid leads to a suspect.
It was bad. It was hard because knowing that we would have to live with the unknown.
6 years passed, and it seemed like the case might never be solved. But finally, a tip led police to take another look at a similar double murder that had happened around the same time.
John and Sabrina were killed a month later after we had another college couple killed here in Sacramento County.
There were many parallels between the two cases.
Meredith Sowers and Craig Miller were last seen early Sunday morning driving away
from
the
Carousel
restaurant.
The last positive sighting of John and Sabrina was here at the...
Both involved attractive college couples who were abducted from a public place, killed execution style, and then dumped around the Sacramento area.
The body was found in a shallow grave.
About 8 o'clock this morning, and the body was
police
found.
Police did make an arrest in the other case. The suspected killer was this man, Gerald Gallego. But as it turns out, on the night John and Sabrina were killed, Gallego had the perfect alibi. He was already in jail. Still, police were sure there was a connection between the murders, and they ultimately arrived at an unusual theory. They believed that John and Sabrina's murder was a copycat crime, staged to clear Gerald Gallego, and to suggest that the real killer was still on the loose. Police believe the man who carried out the killings was David Hunt, Gallego's brother. Hunt had a long list of felony convictions, including a kidnapping.
David Hunt would not be beyond committing a copycat murder to take the heat off of his brother.
Police thought Hunt had received help from his wife, Sue Ellen, and from his frequent partner in crime, Richard Thompson. The three became known in the press as the Hunt Group. And in November 1989, nearly 9 years after Sabrina and John were murdered, the Hunt Group was arrested.
Now Gallego's 45-year-old half-brother, David Hunt, is accused of killing the UC Davis sweethearts.
The worst thing was the why. The worst thing was that the thought that they would kill Sabrina and John to make it look like a copycat murder, you know, to get his brother off in prison. Oh my God.
There was no physical evidence in the case, so detectives leaned on another one of David Hunt's partners in crime, a man named Doug Lehner. They hoped he would turn against the others.
They wanted me to testify that somebody in their group told me about these killings. That's what they wanted.
Lehner openly admits that back then, he was a drug addict and a thief who would steal just about anything.
So you were stealing bed sheets?
Bed sheets from motels. Take 100 sheets, get a couple hundred dollars. It's a dope hustle is what it is.
But Lehner insisted that despite his checkered past, he wasn't a killer.
Were you near Davis, California during this period of time?
No, I didn't even know where Davis was at that time.
But you grew up here in California.
Most of the time I was in jail, man.
Each time detectives visited him, Lehner told them the same thing.
I didn't know about these killings. I didn't know about any of that crap. But they thought I did. So they're gonna put all kinds of pressure on me and squeeze me till I coughed it up. Well, the fact of the matter is, I had nothing to tell.
That's because, Lehner says, they were all innocent.
We didn't do it. Simple as that. Simple. So what could I tell them? They wanted me to lie, man. They wanted me to lie.
After months of denials, Lehner was finally arrested and charged with the murders of John and Sabrina.
They needed somebody, and I was the fall guy.
He and the rest of the Hunt Group were facing the death penalty.
Doesn't look good.
It didn't look good at all.
Were you mentally preparing yourself for the death chamber?
Yeah, oh sure.
You were?
Yeah, of course. You have to.
But on the eve of trial, a stunning piece of evidence was uncovered. Remember that blanket, Sabrina's birthday gift to her sister?
It was determined that there was, in fact, a stain on the blanket.
The stain was semen that had somehow been overlooked all this time. It was ordered tested for DNA.
I said, you know what, man? Now you're gonna find out you got the wrong people. You're lucky you're doing it now before you kill us all.
The new DNA tests could make or break this case. In January 1993, 12 years after the murders of Sabrina Gonzalez and John Riggins, there was a dramatic development in the case against Doug Lehner and the rest of the so-called Hunt Group.
After nearly 3 years in jail, Doug Lehner is a free man today.
The DNA evidence on the blanket, finally tested on the eve of the trial, failed to match any of the suspects. Embarrassed prosecutors had no choice but to drop the charges against all four.
They framed me, actually framed me, and almost got away with it. I could be going to the gas chamber today, and that's an outrage!
The prosecution described you and the others as sophisticated criminals.
Yeah, right. If I look like I'm sophisticated, come on. I mean, that's the problem here. They think we're these sophisticated desperados, and we're not.
The news was devastating to Sabrina and John's parents.
It's like a scab on your heart, you know, that it breaks open and you bleed from time to time, and it never stops.
That looked to us to be the end of it,
To me, it did anyway. I thought, well, that's it. You know, everything they've had is now gone.
Detective Ray Biondi was not surprised when the case collapsed. He had always been troubled by the lack of physical evidence.
It simply appeared to be a case of trying to smash the square peg in the round hole. Make it fit, make it fit.
So did you think it was a fool's errand to prosecute this case?
Yes. This case should have never been prosecuted.
Biondi had another reason to feel frustrated. There were actually four stains on that blanket, all semen. Those stains had only been discovered and tested for DNA some 12 years after he had sent the blanket to the county crime lab.
It's one of those tear your hair out moments. I'm not sure about this, but the blanket was never turned over and the semen stain was actually on the other side.
It must be frustrating to hear that.
Oh.
Tell me.
At that time, with no DNA data bank in existence yet, there was no way to trace the DNA to any other suspects. So once the charges were dropped, the trail went cold.
I even thought of suicide. I really did. I really didn't think I could go on. But you do.
Come on, Brinkley. Brinkley, come on.
Andrea had since married and was a mother of three. Sabrina, Jenna, and Logan. But she found the loss of her sister weighed heavily on her as a parent.
It's been a huge struggle to raise children and not be afraid to lose them every day.
I understand she was very protective of you. And
she's
she still
been.
Is.
Yeah. I think my mom lost the person closest to her in the world. I know it changed her.
What the families didn't know was that there was someone else who had been changed by John and Sabrina's murders.
There's a lot of John Reagans at this ball field.
Journalist Joel Davis.
And when he played baseball, he was a leader on the team.
Joel, now 44, attended high school with John Riggins.
Joel, you said that you left Davis, but this case never left you.
It bothered me. It just sort of bothered me that here were these two people that deserved better, you know, than to just be thought of as murder victims of an unresolved case.
He decided in the year 2000 to write a book about the still unsolved case. Joel had no way of predicting back then that he himself would become part of the story.
When I was reading those court transcripts, you know, there was times the hair on the back of my neck was standing up because it just was a fascinating case.
As he kept digging, Joel realized it was not too late to take a fresh look at the blanket. DNA technology had become more sophisticated, and samples could now be compared to those of convicted criminals stored in a new database.
And I do think that the pot needed to be stirred, and the case needed to be held up to the light.
So in 2002, he contacted the prosecutor in charge of Sacramento's new cold case unit, and didn't let up.
I've had people say, you're obsessed with this, and I'm like, no, I'm not obsessed, I just did my job.
By that time, Joel was doing his job in the face of an overwhelming personal challenge. At the age of 38, he was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease.
How is your health?
When you have Parkinson's, you gotta say the glass is half full. That's the way you survive it. Michael J. Fox likes to say, you know, he calls it the gift that always takes. I was able to get an operation that not everybody's able to get, a deep brain stimulation surgery operation that allows me to move my hand and type, and it actually allowed me to finish this book. I've had my ability to walk taken away, I've had my ability to sign a check taken away, but I can still write.
The Parkinson's may have slowed him down a bit, but Joel's persistence paid off. Investigators reopened the case.
How important was Joel Davis's work?
He put pressure on them to choose this case for them to do this year and not wait and do other cases. In that case, he was invaluable.
Remarkably, within months, there was a hit from the DNA data bank.
And they said it was 1 in 240 trillion.
A 1 and 240 trillion match. Finally, after more than two decades, there was a new suspect tied to the murders through physical evidence.
Couldn't believe it. When I finally pieced together who it was, it was pretty amazing.
And as detectives would soon discover, this man had a very dark past.
Sabrina Gonzalez's mother, Kim, has been waiting 25 years for her daughter's killer to be brought to justice.
There could be other dead bodies. Who knows what the guy's done? To me, he's evil.
Richard Hirschfield, a man authorities in Davis had never even heard of, was now charged in the double murder. A convicted sex offender, his DNA was stored in the FBI database. Authorities say it matched the DNA found on that blanket, that birthday gift meant for Andrea.
You didn't know that this blanket would turn out to be a key piece of evidence.
No, but I'm glad. Whatever it takes, I want this done.
Please be seated and come to order.
For John Riggins' mother, finally facing her son's accused killer as he was arraigned, was bittersweet and disturbing.
You saw him, you were in court, and you saw Richard Hirschfield.
He was looking at whomever was sitting there in court, and it was though we were the caged persons, not him, that it was frightening.
Who is Richard Hirschfield?
They always said it took a pretty smart person to pull this off. He has been described by the authorities as Unabomber smart.
Richard Hirschfield was also dangerous. He was convicted of a violent sex crime some 30 years ago, 5 years before John and Sabrina's murders.
We're lucky to be alive.
Marge and Michelle, two sisters who don't want their last names used, were 22 and 16 when Hirschfield attacked them at Marge's apartment in Mountain View, California in 1975. It started as a robbery at gunpoint.
He had the gun. It had a silencer on it. No one would have heard.
He came prepared.
Oh, very. He had everything. Knife to cut the rope, everything.
Hirschfield tied them up and threatened to kill them. When Marge told him she had no money, he went from robber to rapist.
What did he say?
It was like he was frustrated. He was mad. All right, then. Who wants to be raped? And then my sister offered herself instead of me.
Anybody in my position would have done the same thing. She was my little sister. You know, I mean, she's a sophomore in high school. There was no choice.
So Hirschfield forced Michelle into a closet while he raped her older sister.
It felt like a very long time, sitting and praying. And thinking that I might be a statistic in the newspaper the next day.
Hirschfield was caught 4 days later, lurking outside another apartment complex in the area.
What are you thinking about right now?
How it affected my life and made me fearful. I did things differently than I probably would have done had I not gone through this. Like pushing my bureau up against my door at night so that I could sleep.
Hirschfield served only 5 years in prison for that home invasion and rape. He was paroled in July of 1980. John and Sabrina were killed later that year.
What should happen to Richard Hirschfield now if he's convicted of these crimes?
A 25-cent bullet. How many chances does somebody need?
After being paroled, Hirschfield lived with his younger brother Joe in the town of Arbuckle, some 40 miles from Davis. Authorities believe they were both still living in the area at the time of the Sweetheart murders.
Joe had no criminal background as far as I knew.
Almost 20 years later, in 1999, Joe, an auto mechanic, married Lana.
And he was just a really kind, gentle person and happy, all the time happy.
But Lana never met his brother Richard.
Joe didn't talk a whole lot about his family. He did tell me that the reason he was estranged from his family, that there was some sort of a disagreement.
She and Joe were enjoying their new life together in Beaver Creek, Oregon. But everything changed in November 2002 when detectives came knocking at their door. They wanted to talk to Joe about his brother.
I noticed that his face was quite red. And I asked him if the detectives had come talk to him, and he said yes, they had. And I asked him if that had upset him, and he said yes, it was disturbing.
Detectives had told Joe his brother's DNA was connected to an unsolved double murder. Lana was completely unprepared for what would happen just one day later. She discovered her husband's body in his car. He had committed suicide by carbon monoxide poisoning.
I don't understand how I couldn't be in shock. I'm sure I was in shock.
Police seized as evidence a suicide note left by Joe, a note that would finally help unravel the mystery of the Sweetheart murders. In it, police say, Joe expressed his love for his wife, but said he had been living with this horror for 20 years. Joe then named the killer.
He said Richard did kill those people. He said, I didn't kill anyone. And it would just be a matter of time until they found his DNA there also and would be coming after him.
Detectives always thought that John and Sabrina's killer must have had help leaving the scene.
John Riggins' van was abandoned, so somebody had to be around to pick him up. Very little likelihood the person could have caught a ride somewhere on a very dark highway.
At last, police felt they were heading in the right direction in solving Sabrina and John's murder.
Richard Hirschfield is responsible for your sister's murder.
Oh, I have no doubt he was. I think he was. Yes, I really do.
With the arrest of 58-year-old Richard Hirschfield, Sabrina and John's families believe the prosecution finally has a strong case.
I'd never use the word closure, but a conclusion is near.
There is no closure.
Well, that relieves some of the pain that you've been carrying all these years.
I just want the guy to never be able to get out again. But it's not gonna be a relief for me because I have to live my whole entire life without Sabrina.
Hirschfield pled not guilty, and his attorney, Linda Parisi, insists the case is anything but a slam dunk, despite the DNA on the blanket and the suicide note from his own brother saying Richard did kill those people.
Richard Hirschfield is innocent of these crimes.
Yes.
He did not kill Sabrina Gonzalez and John Riggins.
I believe no. I believe that's absolutely correct. He did not. He was not involved.
Parisi insists that Joe Hirschfield's suicide note should not be admitted into evidence. Whatever role he may have played in the crime remains a mystery. Joe's DNA was not found at the scene. As for the DNA hit on Richard,
I don't know if we can rely on that.
One in 240 trillion.
We don't even know what that number means. Ultimately, we must have confidence in the testing that there was no contamination either at the lab or beforehand in order to trust a result.
But if indeed it is her client's DNA found on that blanket inside the abandoned van, Parisi claims someone could have planted it there.
Certainly there have been cases where DNA has been planted. And
but we're talking about someone's semen.
Right. And there are cases where that has occurred.
Where semen has been planted on evidence?
That's exactly right.
Parisi claims there's another possibility, that Hirschfeld might have been wandering in the area and found the van.
He had the misfortune of stumbling upon this van on the night that Sabrina Gonzalez and John Riggins were murdered, and somehow just left his bodily fluids on this blanket.
That is not beyond the realm of possibility.
Retired Detective Ray Biondi doesn't buy it.
I'd find that to be totally preposterous.
There's someone else who doesn't buy Hirschfeld's innocence. His ex-wife, Lynn, who was briefly married to him 10 years ago. She is speaking out for the first time, and she has a stunning accusation that Hirschfeld molested her son.
He wanted my son for himself. When I look back on it, that was his plan.
To protect her son's privacy, Lynn asked us not to show her face or any recent photos of him. She says when he was a child, she could not understand why her son suddenly became withdrawn.
When he was 7 years old, he was the happiest child you can imagine. And his eyes sparkled and he laughed all the time. And then one day that was gone.
Then, to Lynn's shock, Hirschfeld was arrested for molesting two little girls in their neighborhood.
And I just started piecing all these little things together. And one day I just asked him, you know, I just said, were you molested by Richard? And he said, yes.
Lynn never pressed charges to spare her son the ordeal of a trial. Hirschfeld denies he ever abused him. His conviction for the molestation of the two little girls has since been overturned on technical grounds.
Richard Joseph Hirschfeld, 04.
This time, Richard Hirschfeld faces the death penalty, a punishment Sabrina's father, George, says he deserves.
Even, in fact, the death penalty for him would be a break compared to what he gave the kids, okay? You see, when he took those kids' lives, they didn't get a chance to say goodbye to their parents, and they were suffering.
But with some 100,000 pages of discovery, this case may not go to trial for another year or two.
Well, I think the frustrating part about all of this is whether we'll be alive. I mean, I'm 71 years old. And that is a concern.
Proceedings were further delayed when Hirschfeld was beaten by other inmates and suffered a broken hip. The title of Joel Davis's book, Justice Waits, seems more fitting than ever.
Are you resolved to writing the final chapter of this case?
If I'm bodily able, sure. It's been the most rewarding, fulfilling thing I've ever done.
While Andrea waits for justice for her beloved sister.
Can I put you on a cushion?
She has filled the void in her life by adopting three more children.
Are you okay?
Always okay. With Sabrina in mind.
Careful, Cody.
I wanted to do this, and I wanted this to be in her memory. I was gonna have the kids she didn't get to have.
And as she thinks of that tragic, foggy night, she derives comfort from another one of Sabrina's birthday gifts.
She dated it for my birthday, December 22nd, 1980.
A book on horses, also found in the van.